Deputies Dara O'Brien and Deputy Michael McGrath, you're sharing 15 minutes.
Yeah, Gurnamagadha Cathaoirleach, 10 minutes for myself and 5 minutes for Deputy McGrath, if that's agreeable. Minister, thank you for outlining the position, and I thank the government as well for recalling the Dáil today to discuss this very urgent and important matter. I put it to you that this matter of British exit from the EU and the referendum will be something that will dominate the European agenda and indeed the agenda here in Ireland and in Britain over the coming months. Could I say at the outset, as spokesperson for Foreign Affairs and Trade on behalf of my own party, Fianna Fáil, that I'm deeply disappointed with the decision of the British people, whilst fully respecting that decision held in a referendum. But I think its implications are not yet known, and I think that we as a state in Europe, the European Union itself, will only now be grappling with the serious implications of the decision that's been made by the British people, and in the main that's been made by the English people and by the people in England. And we must remember that the people in Scotland and hundreds of thousands of our own citizens north of the border voted to remain. I think as well that for listening to reports within Britain that over the last, just over the few short days that this has happened, there are many in Britain now who actually feel like outsiders in their own country. And I think that we've got to do our best in a very calm and measured and considered way with our European partners, and through you, Minister, as well, is to ensure that the approach that Ireland takes with the other leaders in Europe through the European Council meeting is level-headed, is calm, and that we don't lead to a situation whereby we make the situation worse in that regard, that Europe are seeing as coming down heavy on Britain. Because whilst we don't like the result of the referendum, we have to respect the result of it and how people actually voted. I would say to you, Minister, that Ireland's role in future negotiations must be central. You already have outlined that, my party leader Micheál Martin also did, that we do have a distinct and unique relationship with Britain, not just through the recent peace process and the Good Friday Agreement and the treaties that emanate from that, but the fact that we share a land border, and thankfully a border over the last 20 years that has become effectively irrelevant. And none of us want to see a hardening of the border there, but because of our trade with Britain, but more importantly because of our people who are in the United Kingdom at the moment, those in the north and those also in mainland Britain, that we must insist that Ireland's unique and distinct position is recognised by our partners in Europe. Indeed, like we joined the European Economic Community together in 1973, and I think for those who would decry the European Union, which is not without its faults, and we all know that, and there are democratic deficits there, but in the main, if you look at the advances that this country has made, not just economically, but socially, the diversity that's come into our communities, the tolerance that has come into Ireland, that is no longer just a homogeneous state, that we have people from across Europe here living, working and raising their families and setting down roots here. And that has been because of the European Union. And my party and I have never made any excuse for the fact that we are pro-European. I consider myself a European citizen as well as an Irish citizen. And it does worry me greatly that there are many in Britain, as I mentioned earlier on, that already feel that they are not part of that society. Now, I do want to just address one matter that was raised earlier on by Deputy Boyd Barrett and Deputy Coppinger, that this idea that this was a workers' revolution within Europe. An absolute nonsense. Total and utter nonsense. And they aligned themselves, whether they like it or not, to a bunch of racist, xenophobic and anti-immigration parties. And you didn't have to scratch the surface too much. I said it a number of weeks ago in a debate that one of the main reasons and one of the main thrusts of this, of the Leave campaign, was anti-immigration and was a one-nation Tory attitude. And that's what it was. And when you had a campaign led by Boris Johnson, former Mayor of London, one wonders would he have campaigned for Leave if he was Mayor of London. I doubt he would have. Nigel Farage and others, British National Party, English Defence League, these are the people that the anti-austerity alliance and People Before Profit align themselves with, and they can't move away from that in any way, shape or form. But we've got to look forward into the future as to how we're actually going to address that. And I would put it to you, Minister, I mentioned at the Foreign Affairs Committee when we had a chance to meet last week prior to the referendum, that I really don't believe over the last number of years, and I know there was a reason in the last year in particular because of elections here in the electoral cycle in Ireland and indeed in Britain, that we have used the North-South bodies and worked them to their potential, that we have not, in my view, used the North-South Ministerial Council to its potential, and that I think it's incumbent on us now. And I'm glad that that meeting is being held, and I hope that future meetings will be scheduled so we know the schedule of them. That is a very, very important vehicle to address the issue, in my view, of how Ireland North and South actually interacts with itself, how East-West relations between Ireland and Britain work into the future. And that is the vehicle, because that's a treaty between our states, yes, underpinned by the European Union. But in the last number of years in particular, I feel that there has been quite a laissez-faire attitude towards that, the All-Ireland bodies and the North-South Ministerial Council in particular. But now is the time to look forward and to use them to their maximum. I think that as far as the negotiations themselves go, we do need to allow a bit of space. Prime Minister Cameron, the British Prime Minister, has decided to resign. But having said that as well, Europe can't just be left in abeyance for a 5, 6, 7 year period. And there is the likelihood maybe of a British general election that some are saying that could happen as early as October, November. So we do need clear heads on it, but we do need to ensure that Ireland North and South, that its specific interests are defended by the government here, and that we're not overtaken by the larger member states in the European Union and the negotiations with Britain on their exit. I do hope and I pray that there is a way out of this, that Britain may decide another course. The referendum in Britain is not legally binding either. I think a new general election there, that's a matter for, obviously, for the Westminster Parliament. But things may change over the course of the next couple of months. But we have to be ready for those eventualities here. I'm glad, Minister, that you've outlined in your speech about the contingency plans that you have in place. I understood why none of them could be published or debated in the last number of weeks, obviously in advance of the referendum itself. I had put those questions to you 4 or 5 weeks ago. But I think we need a cohesive approach within this chamber here, or the elected members here who see the benefit of the European Union and Ireland's membership of it, for our own national interests in Ireland, but also for the betterment of the citizens of Europe. As I said earlier, it is not without its flaws, but I really believe that we have to work together. I would also say to you, Minister, and request through the Government Chief Whip as well, that it should be scheduled a regular update here from the negotiations, not just at committee, but in plenary session here in the Dáil. There have been some very good contributions here today. People are concerned. There are other contributions that I completely and utterly disagree with, but this is the chamber for that to be done. So I think it would be useful through yourself, the Government Chief Whip, that in future to let's have these debates and these updates given in here, and not just only to the Foreign Affairs and Trade Committee. I'll conclude shortly, but just to say that really that this is probably the most seismic political event that's happened within Europe since the end of World War II. And that's not putting a tooth in it, because that's how serious this situation is. Scotland and Scotland's future is something that is within her own gift in relation to the north of Ireland. I think my party leader has outlined our view in relation to the border poll, and that whilst I know this is a long-held position of Sinn Féin, so I don't take it that it was an opportunist position. They have mentioned it before. I think that it would be divisive at this stage to have that border poll. I think it is better that we work through our all-Ireland bodies and the North-South Ministerial Council, British-Irish parliamentary bodies as well, and work through these issues here. But I do wish you well in the coming weeks in the negotiations. This will dominate the agenda, and rightly so. The risks to our own citizens here in Ireland and their economic and social well-being are too great for us not to focus on this in particular. And I'll conclude at that, Cathaoirleach.
Deputy McGrath.
Thank you.